So I welcome you all to today's class. Today's class will be on agrobacterium mediated transformation. Also called as AMT. It's a broad transformation technique that we use in transforming plants. Okay, so the mechanism, the underlying mechanism will be discussed in today's class. So initially what happens, the plasmid, the gene of interest that we want to transform is to be first cloned into your DI plasmid. This DI plasmid is usually present in agrobacterium. Okay, they usually cause crown gall diseases in plants. So the scientists exploited this crown gall formation and used it in transformation of your plants and making transgenic plants. So the first thing what happens is that you have plant cell. For effective transformation, the plant cells need to be wounded first. Okay, these wounding in normal conditions can be mechanical wounding by wind or by various pests that bite on the plant parts. So once the wounding is there, the cell will, or wounding or injury, what we call as the chemical constituents of these will be released into the environment. Okay, and one of the constituents that's released will be a glucose. Now, agrobacterium, if they are nearby, they'll be attracted towards these plants. By a process called as chemotaxis. This chemotaxis is in response to the chemicals. So the movement of or attraction of these bacteria or agrobacterium in this case in response to this chemical glucose, okay, will be chemotaxis, and through this process they will be attracted towards the wound. Right? So earlier there was a notion that acetosyringone, that's a chemical, this is an acetosyringone molecule. Earlier there was a notion that the bacteria or the agrobacterium are attracted towards the plant cells in response to acetosyringone, but that was not found to be true. It was found out that in fact glucose is the molecule, okay, which attracts these bacteria, okay, through a process called chemotaxis, and they move towards the wound. However, this acetosyringone also has a greater role in inducing the genes that are involved in transformation of plant cells. So now what happens? This acetosyringone is a small molecule that is also released with the wound. Okay. It binds on the receptors that are present on the surface of agrobacterium. Okay, and these receptors are called as Vir-A. It's a kinase. Okay, so kinases have kinases on their back, and those kinases have more kinases on their back. So it's a kind of cascade of reactions that are involved in signal transduction. So this estosyringoid molecule binds to the surface receptor or surface kinase, surface molecule, that's your Vir-A or Vir-A. Now these Vir-A molecules are present in form of dimers on the cell surface, right? So once this Vir-A binds with one of the receptors, it dimerizes the two receptors, okay? It dimerizes these two Vir-A receptors. Okay, once dimerization takes place, there is a process called as autophosphorylation, through which a phosphate group is added to this Vir-A dimer. Now, if we kind of make a bigger picture here, this is the surface, okay. This is your Vir-A protein, and your estosyringoid binds with one of the proteins, and it helps in dimerization of this Vir-A. Once they're dimerized, it autophosphorylates itself, okay. Then after this autophosphorylation, it activates this Vir-A kinase, and what happens through a process called as transphosphorylation, it shifts this phosphate molecule to Vir-G. Vir-G is another protein that is present in this agrobacterium. So wounding allows the glucose to release, and through a process of chemotaxis, the agrobacterium are attracted towards this wound. Once they are attracted, the other molecule, estosyringoid, is also released by the plants. That molecule binds to the Vir-A receptors. Once they bind, so they autophosphorylate, add a phosphate group to itself, and once the phosphate is added, then this phosphate is transferred to Vir-G, and it activates Vir-G. So these Vir proteins, two proteins, are not the only Vir proteins. There are other Vir proteins also in the cell. So you have the DNA, and you have Vir-A, Vir-B, then you have G, Vir-C, Vir-D, and Vir-E. Okay, also Vir-F. So these are the other Vir proteins that are present in the cell, okay, that have role in your plant transformation. Now, for example, this is the TI plasmid that is present in the cell. The gene of interest that we want to transform should be between the left border and the right border. Say this is your gene of interest, okay? And this is your other part of the TI plasmid. Usually TI plasmids are around 2, 1, 4, 2, 3, 3 base pairs long. Okay, however, we kind of make it small, because you know one of the properties of a good cloning vector is that it should be smaller in size for efficient transformation. So these genes are present on this Wilms plasmid. And there's a basal expression of these genes due to which the Wilms protein is expressed and it kind of is associated with the membrane, and a smaller quantity of Wilms gene is also present. Okay, what we call as a basal expression. So these are present in minute amounts, but once this Wilms gene is phosphorylated, it activates all these genes and they are expressed, their expression increases and they form, they are translated into proteins, and those proteins are then involved in transforming this gene of interest into your plant cell. Right? Now once this happens, these genes are activated, another gene that comes into play is your Wilms D. Okay? This Wilms D cuts this gene of interest, okay, or the DNA fragment that is between left border and right border. And this Wilms D is covalently attached at the 5' end of this gene of interest. Now once this fragment is nicked out of your TI plasmid, another Wilms gene, that's Wilms E. This Wilms E binds to this gene of interest in dimers. Okay, so two molecules of Wilms E protein, they bind to the gene of interest. Now these will have two functions. Number one, they prevent this DNA from a nuclease attack. Okay. Another is that when this fragment reaches the plant cell, this will ensures that this fragment is translocated into the nucleus, because that's where your chromosomal DNA is, and we want that this DNA should be incorporated into the nucleus and the chromosomal DNA of your plant so that it's expressed and we have a successful transformation and a successful formation of a transgenic or a cisgenic crop. So two functions: number one, it helps the DNA from nucleus attack, from attack from nuclear DNAs, and plus another one is it helps in the translocation of this DNA fragment into the nucleus of your plant cell. But to do that, there should be a link between the plant cell and the bacteria, and that is formed by the protein that's your Wilms B. Wilms B forms a pore or a channel between your plant and your bacteria. So this hole is your endobacterium and this is your plant cell. So you have wounding, then you have release of glucose, agrobacterium gets attracted, then you have release of estrogen. It binds to Wilms A, dimerizes Wilms A, autophosphorylation, it's phosphorylated, Wilms A is phosphorylated, then the phosphate is shifted to Wilms G through transphosphorylation. Wilms G directly activates all these genes, and then when they're expressed, Wilms D helps in cutting this DNA out from the vector between the left border and right border. Once they are cut, Wilms E comes, that's also expressed because of the induction by Wilms G. Once Wilms is expressed, two copies of Wilms binds to your gene of interest, and they have two functions. Number one, they protect this DNA from nuclease attack, plus they help in translocation of this DNA fragment into the nucleus of the plant cell. And to do that, you should have a pore or a channel through which that happens, and that's provided by Virbi. Now, this DNA fragment moves through the spore into the plant cell, and now since the VVE is still attached to it, this VVE will ensure that this DNA fragment goes in the nucleus of the plant cell, where it is incorporated into the genome DNA through many processes, can be recombination, and then it's expressed. If the gene of interest is transformed at a place that is a new chromatin, or that's expressed part of the chromosome, it will be expressed. However, there are chances that this gene of interest can be incorporated at a place that's not expressed at all, like the junk DNA, like the heterochromatin. So that's why when you do a transformation, you do many events, and some of the events are successful, some of the events are not successful. So the whole mechanism how Agrobacterium helps in plant transformation. So why we use these agrobacterium to make your transgenic crops is because these transgenic crops can enhance agricultural productivity. It can help in reduction of your chemicals that are hazardous to the environment. Okay, like one of the projects that we're doing is on cisgenic apple, because we usually in the state of J&K, we use around 300 crore rupees worth fungicide, fungitoxin currents every year. And that's a huge burden on the environment. That's why the incidence of various cancers and disorders are seen in people that are living in the vicinity of apple orchards. So we wanted to make a cisgenic apple that is resistant to scab. So scab is a major economic hurdle or burden on apple producers, because mostly 30 to 40% of the apple is lost due to scab. The good thing is that there are some varieties of apple that do not have the scab, and there are indigenous varieties, like you have the wild apple, you have Malus floribunda, you have Florina, or you have the white dotted red or the Maharaji, that's our local apple variety. So what we're trying to do, we did a comparative transcriptomics of the resistant and the susceptible apple variety. You can have that profile on GEO or Gene Expression Omnibus, that's available online on NCBI, where are the data we have published recently. That's the data of all the genes that are being dysregulated in resistant and susceptible varieties. So we were able to find 40 genes that are able to induce scab, that are highly expressed in scab resistant varieties and are not expressed in, or have a low expression in scab susceptible varieties. And the bad thing is that the scab susceptible varieties are economically viable, like you have the Red Delicious, Golden Delicious, they are kind of liked by consumers. On the other hand, Maharaji is like a little bit sour and does not have a good economic potential. So the goal was to identify these genes and make a cisgenic apple that has this scab resistant gene. So what we did, we found 40 genes. Okay, you can have the information on GEO. Plus, apart from this, we were able to identify 16 transcription factors that are new transcription factors that had not been reported earlier to induce scab resistance. And one of my students, Afshan, is going to work on those. So we are trying to put those, the best ones. So now what we'll do, once we know that these 40 plus 16 is around 56 genes we have, we'll try to see the expression of these genes to confirm the results of your transcriptomics, okay, or RNA-seq that we did. Once it's confirmed, the good genes, two genes we'll take, and we'll try to transform them in your apple varieties that are commercially viable, like you have Red Delicious and Golden Delicious. So if we're successful, we'll be able to. So we have got a vector that is called as PMF1. Okay, we have a kind of kind gift from Wageningen University. So we'll be using this vector to transform our local economically good varieties. So they were able to produce an apple that is resistant to scab. So the burden that's on the environment will kind of come down. We'll not have to use like the 300 crores of fungicide toxicants every year. Plus the 40% loss that annually we have, that's a huge sum of money. So we'll be able to kind of prevent that. So there are many uses apart from these of this. We can kind of improve various agronomic qualities of plants, or we can enhance the nutritional value of foods, like you have seen in golden rice 1 and 2, where they have incorporated carotenoid-basidic pathway in endosperm, usually in endosperm. The white part that you eat, it does not have carotenoids. However, the leaf parts, it has the carotenoids. And a small portion of carotenoids is present in the allelome zone, that's on the outer side, but not in the endosperm. So we usually polish this rice before eating because it has high quantity of fats, and with time, fats get rancid and it can spoil your rice godowns, right? So we remove it through polishing. So what scientists did, they incorporated phytoin synthase, phytoin desaturase, and zeta-carotene desaturase, and lycopene beta-cyclase. So these are 4 genes that are involved in carotenoid biosynthesis. However, they were able to transform 3 genes, phytoin synthase, earlier from Narcissus, pseudo-Narcissus, then from maize, and lycopene beta-cyclase, okay? And also 1 gene, carotene isomerase, or phytoin desaturase from Erwinia uridula, that's a bacteria. And the good thing about using this bacterial gene is that it does a work of two genes in plants. If you have 2 genes like phytoin desaturase and zeta-carotene desaturase, they add like 4 double bonds. In this case, this alone adds 4 double bonds in your phytoin, okay? And makes lycopene and then makes beta-carotene. And we transformed these genes in rice, and they should express in your endosperm. If you remember earlier lectures, you can see our earlier YouTube videos in which we have studied the promoters, and you know that we use promoter gluten in that case because gluten is the gene that's expressed in the endosperm. So we put a gluten promoter ahead of our gene of interest so that when the genes are incorporated into the endosperm, they are expressed because the cell will think that this is a gluten gene and it will express it. But in reality, this is a phytoin synthase that we have put. So we fool the cell, we deceive the cell, it expresses these 3 genes, and you have carotenoids that are produced in rice. So that's why this rice is golden in color. That's why it was called as golden rice. So you can improve nutritional quality of rice or any plants, okay, using transgenesis or this system. So you can increase biotic or abiotic stress, like our lab was working on one of the genes, that CBF1, that's a cold responsible C repeat binding factor. It has the property that it induces cold tolerance in plants. So we have cloned a highly efficient CBF1 from a cold tolerant variety Pusa Sheetal, and in fact, we filed a patent for that, because the gene that we produce is a fusion protein of GFP and CBF. So if you want to do localization studies, you clone a gene, you put a tag, a fluorescent tag with it, okay? Once the fluorescent tag it with, wherever your gene will go, you'll have a tag, you'll be able to know the localization. So this construct that we have made has importance in conducting studies of localization, that how in response to cold this gene behaves. So also one of the scientists, Dr. Asif Shikari, and his lab recently made a Mushkibudji, that's a local variety, blast resistant variety, by incorporating 3 genes. Though they did this with breeding and marker assisted selection, you can do it faster with transgenesis, okay? So good thing also about transgenes and cisgenes is that you don't have a linkage drag, because with time what happens is if you produce some species with breeding, first of all it takes time. The apple varieties that you eat today, they are a result of thousands of years of breeding experiments. Okay, so you don't have so much time. So what you do, simply take a gene, put it in the apple, and bingo, you have a scab resistant apple. So the linkage drag that's associated with these plants that are produced through breeding, so the one advantage is good advantage that you don't have that linkage drag. But when you kind of make these transgenes, you have to have permission from various governing bodies. In India, we have an area of bodies from which we have to take permission before we make a transgene or a cisgene. Okay. So they are all under Ministry of Environmental, Forest and Climate Change. These all bodies that regulate transgenic research are under the Ministry of your Environment and Climate Change and Forestry. And there are six competent authorities that work directly below this ministry. You have RDAC or Recombinant DNA Advisory Committee. Then you have Genetic Engineering Appraisal Committee that works under RDAC. Then you have Review Committee on Genetically Modified. Review Committee on Genetic Manipulations. Okay. Then at institutional level, we have IBSC, Institutional Biosafety Committee. Okay, in which you have a member from the university plus one member from DBT, or that's a governing body. So if you want to do some research, we have to take permission from IBSC. Okay, later these IBSC give us the permission. In the meantime, they get the permission from these ministries so that our research is. They check that our research is well contained and there is no environmental risk in conducting this research. Because sometimes you are dealing with toxic genes, okay, if these genes kind of go out in the environment and are transformed into your crop plant, the plant that you eat, then that can be toxic to you. Okay, so these committees help in regulating the things. Then you have SBCC, okay, or State Biotechnology Coordination Committee. Then you have the DLC, or the District Level Committee. These are the six committees that are the regulating bodies that work under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. Okay. And they have produced a guidelines that we call as 1989 guidelines. Okay, so these guidelines were revised in 1998 and 2008. So they give a list of SOPs and various features that should be kind of considered while making a transgenic or a cisgenic crop. So they allow you to do a research. Once you are completed the research, then the committee sits and sees that your crop is good, can be released. Okay, so the prior to release, there is a case by case review of all the transgenic plants that are there. Okay, and to check their potential adverse effect on environment. So if they find that there are no risks, they continue. So the risk that they assess is based on 4 points. First, number one is on risk identification. Then they characterize the risk or risk characterization. And then after characterization, they check the consequence, the likelihood assessment. Okay, and then they evaluate. So after evaluation, they will check the level of concern, or the negligible, or the low, or the moderate, or the high. So once these four steps are done, they can give the permission to release or not to release a variety that we make. Okay. So this should be all about today's lecture.